Hello world, it's Siraj, and have you ever wanted to create songs using AI? It's totally possible, and I've got my friend Taryn here to help me explain how it all works.
Thank you for having me.
Anytime.
I've been watching your videos for a while and very excited about this moment in time.
Thank you.
Hey everybody, I'm Taryn Southern, and I've been a YouTuber for quite a long time. Got my start making music videos on YouTube about 10 years ago, and recently released my first single off of my upcoming album, which is composed entirely with artificial intelligence, as Siraj said. So really been exciting to work with this new medium.
Totally, it's super cool. You guys gotta check it out. Links are gonna be in the description. Okay, so why did you wanna create songs using AI?
I think it seemed like a great challenge. You know, I like doing things that I haven't done before. Music creation has always been a little bit of a mystery to me because I don't play instruments. I grew up trying to learn how to play guitar, but my hands were so small and not very nimble across the guitar that I basically gave up. Yeah. I played a little bit of piano, but I had this narcoleptic piano teacher who would fall asleep halfway through the lesson, so that didn't work out so well either. So for me, writing music in my 20s and adulthood really just became about writing by ear. And so when I found a few pieces of software that could actually write music using code, I got really excited because I thought now finally someone like me who doesn't play instruments could potentially make the music that I hear in my head with this new collaboration partner. So it was an exciting challenge, and it was like crossing new frontier.
Totally, yeah. I mean, who does that? I mean, and this new partner being AI.
Yep, and they never get tired or hungry.
That's true. You don't need to have Doritos or Cheetos or what, anyway.
And if you don't like their song, you just throw it out.
You throw it out the window. It's gone. It's out of here. Okay, so tell us about the process you use to do this with AI.
Yeah, so it's different depending on the software. And there are now a number of different AI software companies out there that can compose music, from Google Magenta to Amper to AI Music, Iva, IBM Watson. Like, I'm forgetting some of the main ones I'm collaborating with. So they all function differently depending on the neural network and how the engineer has actually created the interface. So I will say that the easiest one to use, if you just want to get started and understand what kinds of things AI can actually create musically, Amper. And that's the one that I used for the single that I released in September called Break Free. The cool thing about Amper is it actually produces all of the music. So what I mean by that is all the instrumentation that you hear in that song is actually put together using AI. It was not a musical track composed by AI, performed by humans. So it gives you a sense of what's possible, because it's actually really hard to take random musical sounds and put them together into something cohesive that sounds good. So I would start with Amper. That's my cat, Tiggy. No, that's what Siraj's backpack.
No, it's all
Tiggy,
good. I mean,
don't do that.
It happens.
She's destroying your backpack.
Oh man, I'll just have an AI make one with generative adversarial networks, right? Okay.
Perfect. So if you're looking to do the most basic kind of introductory lesson in AI music creation, I would go to Amper. If you are familiar with code and you want to get your hands a little bit dirty, I would say Google Magenta or IBM Watson are great places to go. Google Magenta, their software, and they have a number of different programs available for AI music writing that do different things. It's all available on GitHub, I think.
Yeah.
IBM Watson is actually releasing their software open source in January. And I've been using that the last month to write stuff, and I love it. It's cool. So you do need to have knowledge, coding knowledge. You'll be using Terminal to write most of your songs.
Oh, yes.
I had to, like, for the first couple weeks on it, I was calling their developers being like, wait, how do I do this thing? So basically with a program like Watson or Magenta, you're going to set different musical parameters. Like what type of song you want the AI to create. Is it pop? Is it reggae? Is it a mixture of reggae and pop? What's the tempo? What's the BPM? What are the instruments that you want embedded into the track? And in some cases you can also give the AI a track or a multitude of tracks to teach it basic rules based on those tracks that you like. So if you want to make a song that sounds like the Beatles, you basically just feed it a whole catalog of Beatles songs. It'll do its thing, and then you say, I want the song that it creates to be a reggae track. So now you've got a reggae track inspired by the Beatles.
God, that's awesome.
Right? So, so there are a lot of, depending on how skilled you are at coding, there are a lot of ways that you can take these softwares to do really cool things. There's a program in Google called InSynth, which allows you to actually take two disparate sounds and combine them together. So I could actually record my cat Tiggy scratching on Siraj's backpack and then combine that with the sound of nails on a chalkboard to create a truly delightful, Tiggy decided to say hi.
Yes.
This is the little runt that's ruining the video.
What a, I can't even fake it. I don't really like cats that much. It's okay. Bye.
But essentially, I mean, you can create a whole, an entirely new sound using some of these tools and inject that into your musical work. So this all goes to say that they function differently depending on which you choose to use and your coding knowledge and your musical knowledge. But it is absolutely untrue that using AI is not a creative process. It's so creative because there are so many different avenues that you can take in creating a song and creating new sounds. And I actually think that it has the ability to bring out the super composer in all of us.
Totally. Awesome. So how does Amper make this all happen? Well, it's proprietary technology, so we're out of luck. See you next time. Just kidding. We can totally reverse engineer how it's very likely done looking at some of the latest research in deep learning. We know that one popular way to class machine learning algorithms is into categories of generative and discriminative models. Discriminative models classify data into sets of categories. They allow us to differentiate between different types of data. Generative models, on the other hand, offer even more exciting possibilities, creating new data after going through a training phase. One type of generative model are called the audio synthesis models. These are useful across a range of applications that we use day to day, including text-to-speech systems, the kind that Google Translate uses to help dictate what you've just translated, or the kind that voice assistants use to respond to our requests. Generic synthesizers have been used in music extensively and have a long history in that field. From DJs to terrible hip-hop producers like T-Pain, they're usually hand-designed instruments that accept control signals like pitch and velocity to shape the tone and dynamic of a sound. Synthesizers have had a huge impact on culture and music the past few decades, as some of the most popular songs out there have used them. So the traditional way of doing this was to use some sort of arrangement of oscillators or an algorithm for sampling playback. But a newer way to do this is by using a data-driven approach. That is, letting an algorithm learn from musical data. Mm-hmm. It's possible to create new types of expressive and realistic instrumental sounds using deep learning. We know that deep learning allows us to learn features from data. And in the case of music, these features can represent tone, timbre, dynamics, crunkness. All of these can be tunable knobs for a music generator. Google has been at the forefront of a lot of progress in AI-generated music, and they have an open-source project called Magenta. Magenta embodies a lot of the recent models that have been published in that field. A more recent model, just published a few months ago, used two concepts together. The first was a WaveNet-style autoencoder that learns temporal hidden nodes to capture longer-term structure.
Exactly. And the second was called InSynth, which is an enormous data set of music that can be used to explore neural audio synthesis of musical notes, just like I mentioned earlier. So InSynth contains about 300,000 four-second annotated notes from about 1,000 musical instruments, an order of a magnitude more than any other similar data set. So it's pretty powerful. And like I said, you can combine sounds of your cat with, I don't know, anything.
Anything.
Which is pretty cool.
DeepNet created a system called WaveNet. It generated raw audio waveforms, and WaveNet models the conditional probability of a waveform to generate new music. It uses all previous samples and other parameters to do this. The authors of our audio synthesis paper were inspired by that model to create something similar to WaveNet. There were two motivations here. The first was to be able to create music that had a consistent long-term structure so that the theme would carry out through the end of the piece, unlike anything off of Yeezus. The second was to use the learned features for applications, like using meaningful audio interpolations, like between different instruments, for example, like what Taryn did. In the original WaveNet architecture, at each step of training, a stack of dilated convolutions predicted the next sample of audio from a fixed size input of prior sample values. The joint probability of some audio was factorized as a product of conditional probabilities between the different waves. But these researchers removed the need for external conditioning. Instead, it works as an autoencoder, a generic one, taking in raw audio waveform as input from which the encoder produces an embedding. Then they shifted the same input and fed it back into the decoder, which reproduced the input waveform. So using the joint probability, they could parameterize the feature as a latent variable. To train the model, they used gradient descent, the most popular optimization scheme out there. Shout out to gradient descent. And it uses the difference between the predicted output and the actual output as an error value. Then using that error, it calculates a gradient. And using that gradient, it subsequently updates the weight values of the network over time to give it better predictions. It was trained over 1,800,000 iterations, a really long time. For the training data, even though nSynth annotated every single note using its unique pitch and timbre and dynamics, they decided to further annotate it, giving each sound a source, a family of instruments, and a sonic quality. Even though training this type of deep learning model requires a massive amount of computing power, you could just download a model from GitHub and run it on Google Cloud or AWS. This stuff is democratized, so you have access to computing power if you use the cloud. Or you could just pull a model off of the Magenta GitHub page or use experiments.google.com and play with it in your browser. So, three things to remember here. Generative machine learning models that can learn latent variables from a data set can be used to generate new data similar to the training set. You can use a WaveNet style autoencoder and the nSynth dataset if you'd like to experiment with state-of-the-art machine learning for music generation. And WaveNet is perhaps the most powerful model out there to perform audio generation.
You have a really smart audience.
Thank you. It's all about them. They are very smart.
If you want to see more AI music, you can follow me at youtube.com/Taryn.
There we go. Please subscribe for more programming videos.
And I think we got to go. We got to go make some AI music.
It's true. So, thanks for watching.